Welcome everyone to MailFuzz TV. I am Peter, that is Tara, and we are going to talk about Star Trek Picard Season 3, Episode 3. It's called 17 Seconds. So full spoilers for the episode as always. I have many thoughts on this episode. I do. I'm sure you probably do too. I want to make a request though, Tara, before we get into this in depth. I would like to request that we do not spoil any more of Deep Space Nine than has already been spoiled in the show. Don't give me the eyebrows. Don't do it.
But it's the best part of this episode.
It is the best part of this episode, but I'm also annoyed because I went through 4 seasons of Discovery, 2 seasons of Picard without getting a single thing from Deep Space Nine spoiled. And now that I've actually started Deep Space Nine, I'm halfway through season 1, now they decide to start hitting us with Deep Space Nine. My heart sank. My heart sank the second I realized what something in this episode was connecting to in Deep Space Nine. And I went, no! I mean, it's
better catch up.
It's exciting because it is the most interesting thing they've done this season, and it's nice to honour the fact that Deep Space Nine, you know, is something they should probably connect to in some way, but it's also spoiling stuff that I very actively in the reviews with Connor, I've been talking about, I hope they explore this more, I hope they explore this character more, and they hit me with all this shit in Picard Season 3. God damn it.
Well, you should have been a fan a long time ago.
I can't turn back the time. I can't turn back the clock and go back this to the past.
This is your penance, Peter.
So yeah, we'll get into it. That said, though, I have a lot of things I'm going to critique in this episode. But it's a Picard review from us, so you should expect that by now.
I did not like this episode.
Hey, it's the last season. 7 more left. 7 more left, and we never have to talk about Picard ever again.
I didn't like this episode.
I didn't like a lot of this episode as well. I liked the thing that revealed that ties back to Deep Space Nine, even though I'm mad at the show for doing it. I mean, it's not a genuine critique, don't get me wrong. I can't blame the show and say they shouldn't be touching Deep Space Nine because I've not seen it. That's unfair. I'm joking like I am. Obviously, that's not a fair critique. But on a personal level, I'm like, F you, you bastards. How dare you? Stop talking about Dominions and other
wars. Are you not upset that it spoiled Voyager for you?
Voyager's not meant to be very good. Like, Voyager's not got a reputation.
Season 1 of Voyager is pretty great. And there's a lot of great stuff in Voyager. It's not Deep Space Nine.
I'm actually excited about the plot of Deep Space Nine, though. You know, I'm excited. And I even like Odo as a character, and I'm excited about the mystery of, like, what he is and where he comes from and all that stuff. And this episode just starts just pissing it out from every orifice.
Well, you should have caught up.
Should have caught up.
I do. I like that... Deep Space Nine has a presence in this show since they have like the best part of Voyager in the show. And so much of Deep Space Nine has been like glossed over by the Star Trek execs. And like, even when it was like coming out, it was considered the, no offense to redheads, but it was considered the redheaded stepchild of the series, of the franchise.
All the offense to the redheads. Thank you very much.
Well, I didn't mean any offense.
I endorse it.
I love red hair.
I also endorse it wholeheartedly.
So the first thing I dyed was red when I dyed my hair.
It's the first thing I dyed. Was that code for the first person I killed had red hair? My first victim. I kid.
The first time I dyed my hair, I said, I want to be a redhead.
I record shows with the ginger. I make a lot of ginger jokes as part of the fun. No actual disrespect to any of the gingers out there.
Good. My mother's a ginger. It's true.
I have a lot of critiques of this episode. I have some problems with Picard's character in this episode. And how out of character he feels like he gets by the end in a way that didn't make any sense to me. despite the fact that Worf's there, I still think Raffi's plot is really poorly written, and even though it gets to some of the reveals we were talking about that we're going to bring up, I do think it's still this just a chase for MacGuffin plot. That's just by the end of the plot, all it is they stole that weapon because it's concealing the real dangerous weapon they might have stole. Let's go hunting for what they might have stole. It's all just another mystery MacGuffin that there might be a thing. We have to go look into it.
What if the real weapon is Wesley Crusher?
His name was uttered. Beverly mentioned her dead son. Well, not dead, but you know what?
Beverly.
You know.
Yeah.
Yeah. The transcendent
the
son.
The stars took him.
Yes. The stars took him. They took her husband. They took her parents. They've taken her son. So now she's got Jack. And any theories that Jack might have been like not the natural conception or anything like that, all out the window this episode, because they have the conversation. They have the...
Well, I mean, still somewhat in the air. I mean, Nemesis... Or what was the last one? Yeah, Nemesis was pretty late in the game for Dr. Beverly Crusher. If they hooked up after that... there had to have been something going on, right? Unless in the future, women just stay fertile longer.
Yeah, menopause doesn't kick in until your 60s in the future. Yeah, that's what it is.
I mean, I suppose it could kick in that late now, but I don't know. I mean, you're considered like geriatric pregnant if you get pregnant after like 35.
I was going to say maybe Beverly's just got great genes, but then Wesley exists, so I don't know. I don't think I could say that with a straight face.
Wesley was great though, right? I mean, he was chosen by the Travelers.
Okay, and the kayfabe of the show, yes, he's spoken about as if he's this like gift, you know, this wunderkind kind of child. But that wasn't my joke, okay? So, yeah.
Poor Will Wheaton.
Yeah, so the episode is very much, they're in this nebula, the Shrike ship is chasing after them. And we'll get into all that as well. But I think the first thing to talk about probably is the Picard and Beverly conversation, the story of her having this kid, not telling Picard about him, and Picard... Like, I actually didn't hate Picard in this scene. I thought he made some...
No, me neither.
I thought he made some very valid points about, like, you know, you could have told me about the son, and you took the choice. Because her argument is, well, you know, every time the universe comes running for a savior, you always, like, have to go and be Picard. You have to go and do the thing, right? And I was worried that, you know, he'd be in danger. You're always in these dangerous situations. And his, you know, response to that, which I thought was perfectly valid, was, well, you never give me a choice to leave that. Like, you know, had I known I had a son, I might have said, no, I'll go and prioritize that instead.
Yeah, there's a lot about this conversation that I hated. I do think that Picard is acting very much in character in this. I think Beverly is acting very out of character. I think
that's fair.
Her bringing up that you always said that you didn't want to be a father, that you didn't want to be like your own father. And I'm sure that's a very personal line for Patrick Stewart and all that, since we learned about all the his personal history with his father and mother growing up in the last season. But like, okay, let me get my thoughts together here. What do I want to say first?
Peter, you're so amazing.
We know, God, we know that he is a good father because we've seen the inner light. And I know this show knows about the inner light because they showed the piccolo, they showed the flute, but like nothing else in that episode matters. Like the idea that he raised a child played by his own son, whatever his name is, Greg Stewart or something. Like he is a good dad. And the conversation probably would have changed after that. Like maybe he wouldn't have wanted to be a father because he already had that and it was taken away from him. Or, I don't know.
To play a little devil's advocate, I'll just say that while he may have talked about that experience, Beverly didn't witness that life. I mean, I'm not really defending what she said here. I'm just throwing it out there just for the argument you've put out.
It seems very strange that Beverly is... on the side of, I'm just going to hide him from you. And then when he's old enough, I'll give him the choice to find you or whatever. It just seems very out of character. Well, it's not like he's a monster or like she says, you always have a target on your back, but he's in Starfleet. Like they'll protect him. They'll protect their family. Like what? It doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah.
Like, and none of the explanations that they gave were satisfying.
In Star Trek The Next Generation, it never feels like Picard's this type of like thrill-seeking captain who puts himself and his crew in a lot of danger. He's very by the book. He makes a lot of sensible decisions. So the person she's kind of talking about in this scene doesn't feel like the Picard mm-hmm. that we know from that show. And the other thing that I had a problem with was she has a line towards the end of this scene where she's like, she called Picard for help because, so this strike came after us. You know, we were doing this good work to help refugees or help poor people in different planets, you know, medical aid and whatever. And these people showed up and this giant strike ship showed up after us. And she says, this is clearly a ship from an enemy of Jean-Luc Picard because it's a Picard size, like, you know, villain. And I'm like, what? What is your logic here? That you assume that someone's coming after Jack because they're trying to like provoke Picard when he didn't even know about his own... I don't know. Like her logic didn't make any sense to me.
Yeah, and the other thing is like she's talking about how he's got a target on his back, but like according to Jack, they've been like on these crazy adventures the whole time where they're in very dangerous situations, yeah. And like Beverly's a badass now. With shooting rifles at people, like I don't.
You're right. The life she's living with Jack completely contradicts the life she's supposedly saving him from. Because that's the big line she has in the scene. She says, "I know I can take care of my son, but I don't think I can take care of yours." That's the big line she has towards like that. And I'm like, I feel like he'd be safer hanging around the vineyard. To be honest, it feels a lot more like low key for the most part.
Probably.
Admittedly, he wasn't on the vineyard at the time when she made this choice. He was still in Starfleet, you know, captaining a ship or whatever. But it's I don't know. None of everything she said just felt like writing forced to justify what the plot of this show is, rather than because any of it makes sense with the characters that we know from the original show.
It doesn't make any sense to me.
No.
It doesn't make any sense. Nothing lines up.
The only moment that Beverly felt kind of in character when she was running around Medbay trying to help people with her doohickey, and I was like, yeah, this is Beverly Crusher. This is the one thing I remember of Beverly Crusher.
she can handle a crisis, yeah.
Yeah, she's a doctor. That was kind of it. And like, if you want to tell me she's changed, if you want to give me like, oh, she's changed in these past 20 years, that's fine. But like, I don't think anything they've done has given me a compelling reason. Like, all of this seems like based on a decision she made 20 years ago that doesn't fit to who I think any of these characters are. And then she kind of ended up, like you say, becoming this dangerous lifestyle with her son anyway, which means, I don't know, seems like maybe he'd have been better off nestled in Starfleet where they're surrounded by protection all the time.
Yeah, I don't know. It doesn't make any sense to me. It's super frustrating to listen to. And on top of other things that happened in the episode, I just thought that was like the most unsatisfying reason for this. Like, I really wanted Jack Crusher to not be his son.
Yeah, so did I. I mean, I said in episode one, I hope he's not his son. Like, but I'm dreading that he is. And in episode two, the one positive thing I said about it is at least they pulled the plaster off early, the band-aid, sorry, for the Americans. You know, they did it quickly. It's like, we're not going to tease this out for half the season. We're just going to do it now. But even in this episode, this idea that Jack chose not to pursue Picard mm-hmm. and didn't want to go and meet him, okay, that could be interesting. The little follow-up scene where Jack's with Riker, like, don't get me wrong, I thought Riker felt in character the way he was kind of gawking at him. It felt very much a Riker thing to do. But the conversation itself, I thought, was a little weird because it was very much this... you know, here your legends don't live up to what they're supposed to be or something like that. So the only hint we have right now from Jack's perspective is that he's worried that Picard and indeed the rest of the Next Gen crew wouldn't live up to this fantasized version that Beverly talks about when she talks about her adventures on the Enterprise, which is what he says. He says, oh, he talks about the whole crew all the time, and she gets really, her eyes light up, but then she gets kind of sad because those days are over.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't have too much to say about that scene. I thought Riker was not good in this episode also.
I think,
like, he's not acting like himself, unless they're trying to say that he's a changeling and, like, he's the saboteur also. But it seems like they're just, like, you know, lower deck saboteurs inside the ship.
I had way more problem with Picard for the rest of the episode than I did Riker. I felt like Picard was the one who's been oddly aggressive, who wanted to fight and kept trying to, like, every time Riker gave a good reason why they should do a certain thing, which was effectively try and run away because they're not, you know, the ship's not capable of fighting this thing, Picard's constantly just trying to circumvent him into combat, like, constantly. And then when he eventually gets his way towards the end of the episode, the whole thing just kind of, you know, they lose. So I actually thought a little bit of the ship combat was interesting because they introduced this idea that the portal weapon that was used to, like, you know, destroy that building back in episode one, this ship has that portal weapon. So they do this thing when the Titan's about to get out the nebula, they fire a portal in front of them and they end up just flying back into the nebula.
I thought that was neat.
That's kind of neat. That's an interesting mechanic. So it made Picard look like an absolute freaking idiot. I'm trying not to swear. When he's like, fire everything we've got, and I'm like, are you surprised they just opened a big portal and directed all your weapons back at you? Is that, are you really shocked at that?
Yeah, it was a cool move.
Well, it's a dumb move on Picard's part.
Well, yeah, but it was a cool move on the Shrike's part.
Oh, sure, yeah, they think about
to use the portal to send everything they got back at him.
Amanda Plummer is living up to her father's legacy here. She's doing a good job, but I mean, she didn't really have any
lines.
She's
mostly in the shadows this episode. We didn't really get to see too much of her.
She's barely a character in this episode. She's just kind of like watching and saying fire occasionally.
They could have gotten someone else to just like sit there for the filming of it.
Oh, yeah.
We can't afford Amanda Plummer. Just keep her in silhouette.
very straight. And they try to do this thing as well where I really hate this kind of forced narrative in movies and TV where, like, they try and act as if Picard, because he now has a son, that he suddenly has this father-son bond. So at the start of the episode, we get this flashback to when Riker's...
Yeah, he definitely shouldn't.
Yeah. When Riker's first son was born, we get this flashback to when it's just after that's happened and he's in the bar with Picard, and this is, you know, after the movies, I think. Unless this happened somewhere in between the movies. I don't think it did, though.
Yeah, it would have been after.
Would have been after. This son that didn't last. But he's with Picard. Picard's making a speech. And then Troy calls him and is like, get back here. The baby's vomiting all over the place or whatever, blah, blah. But the whole point of it is that Riker's telling him this story that when he was called to the delivery room, they said there was something wrong. And, you know, for the 17 seconds he was in the turbo lift, it was the longest 17 seconds of his life. And they recreate this later with Picard because Jack is a little hurt and they're like, he's in Red Bay, and Riker's like, go. So we get Picard in the turbo lift looking all like, my boy, my sweet baby boy, and I'm like, I just,
what did they do to my boy?
Because that was the part of the conversation between Riker and Picard that really annoyed me, is when Riker's calling it Picard, he says, look, I know you've got a son on board now, so you're not thinking straight. And I'm like, I refuse to believe that finding out he's got a son who's already in his 20s is making him, like, suddenly alter how he thinks. Like, this is stupid.
Yeah, I agree. Plus, he's a robot, so he would just do whatever the most logical robot thing would do.
He doesn't think like a robot, though.
I know. I hate that he's a robot.
So do I.
But I... When Riker's telling the story, all I can think of is... Why don't you just do an emergency transport? Why wait the 17 seconds? It sounded like it was an emergency. Why doesn't anybody use emergency transports on the ship to just go from deck to deck? It don't make no sense.
That's a interesting point. I can't dispute that.
And then Picard's doing it also. If he really is going through that tunnel vision of 17 seconds on the turbo lift, bloop. Emergency transport, sick bay.
maybe. I mean, they're being fired upon at the time, so you could argue maybe, the ship's too busy doing all these other things to give him emergency transport for that.
I did kind of like seeing Deanna on the comms and stuff, the visuals, and trying to like get him to come back, telling him to bring the whiskey, because I just got like little hints of Luxana, of her mother in it. just the craziness of
it. Oh, sure. Okay.
And I thought, oh, that's kind of cool if, like, she has a kid and she kind of unwillingly becomes her mom. A little bit.
We have to talk about the fact. So Riker ends up in command of the ship because when they first get found by the Shrike.
Shaw's hurt, yeah.
Yeah, Shaw gets hurt when the ship's attacked. And he transfers command to Riker, says, oh, you get us out of this mess. You take us out of it. So Shaw is, unfortunately, mostly just kind of, like, away for most of the episode. You see him hurt on the table at one point, and you know he has a couple of lines early on when he's like given commands before he gets hurt, but for the most part he's kind of like shifted to the side so we can have Riker and Picard being the ones making the calls. And they do the thing early on where Picard says, you should call me number one, Will, and it's like, okay, that's kind of sweet, it's a role reversal, whatever. But that's like just to kind of like show them being happy with each other, because the rest of the episode they're just going to gradually get more and more in conflict, to the point where at the end of the episode Riker says, you just got us all killed, remove yourself from the bridge.
That seemed very un-Riker like also.
Yeah, I still think Picard was acting more a character because I don't really know why he was being so aggressive.
He was using logic to say, like, you have to fire at her. You have to fight because blank, blank, blank. I can't remember the reasons exactly, but he had his reasons for saying that this is the strategy we need to approach, but it was just wrong. It was the wrong strategy.
I don't know. He kept pushing it in such a way. It just felt like a character to me, though. It felt too aggressive. It felt like
Felt like he also couldn't handle not being the captain in that moment.
Riker's logic made more sense to me in the episode. Now, if it turns out that he's a changeling, then fair enough. If it turns out Picard's a changeling, I don't know how we deal with that if he is, but whatever. Which I guess we have to get to the changeling.
He's a robot and a changeling.
I suppose we have to get to
my brain.
Yeah, actually, so as much as I'm saying I'm excited by the prospect of what they're talking about, but it doesn't make me excited for this show. It makes me excited to watch the rest of Deep Space Nine. I want to make that clear. It's not that I'm excited for what this show is going to do with it. But the thing that bugged me is that the character, like the ensign or whoever it is on the ship, who turns out to be like the saboteur, the one who's leaving the trail, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's like one shot of him looking maybe slightly villainous on the bridge very early on. So later on, when it's like, oh, he's the saboteur, I'm like, we saw him for like a second. That, like, that was your setup for who the saboteur is? Is this one guy we saw looking ominous?
I mean, yeah, I didn't care if it was someone that we didn't really know. I mean, it wasn't a big deal until he gets punched in the face and we see the goo form and you're like,
oh yeah, oh, the liquid. Yeah, no.
That's the exciting part.
I don't mind it being not someone we knew, but you either set him up properly or you make him just be someone completely new when he shows up, right? This one moment of like him looking ominous was just like, this is worse than either extreme. This is just shit.
I guess it didn't really bother me, like, that much.
You want the credit for seeding him, but giving us one shot of him just looking is not really a seed. It's I don't know. It annoyed me. It annoyed me. But meanwhile,
do we think that there's only one saboteur?
I guess the best answer, Tara, is that I just don't give a shit.
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
I mean, that's the stuff that I'm actually kind of excited about for the show and hoping that this is the thing that saves season three for me. Because, okay, I have another problem. And it's mostly the scene between LaForge and Seven.
Oh, yes, yes.
I thought that scene was awful. That scene was Seven is in her is confined to her quarters because for insubordination. And LaForge comes down with someone else and knocks on the door and says, my father also didn't have friends. And he was one of the greatest engineers in all of Starfleet. And everybody remembers him as this legend. And I'm just thinking, like, was it really necessary to make everybody a legend?
I think
it's so strange because in my mind, I just want to finish this.
Sure, sure.
In my mind, joining Starfleet means that you're one of the best already. And then going out into adventures, like, we get to see the adventures of the Enterprise, but every ship has its own adventures and they all have the best crew. You know, it's nothing. Like, what is it that makes these guys legends just because they were on the D?
The big, you know, D. They were on the big fat D.
Yeah, they said it was the fat one.
Yeah, that's
I just
I agree with this.
I found it so annoying.
I agree with this, and I think this is the Ghostbusters Afterlife. We have to have 50 shots of the proton pack turning on because it means something to the audience.
Well, the other thing, if I could just finish though, like the other thing that really pissed me off about it is her saying all this stuff about LaForge and about Geordi LaForge, and Seven at the end of it's like, thank you. Yes. Like, what? No, like, he means absolutely nothing to Seven, and he shouldn't mean anything to Seven, but he means something to the audience. And it's just so blatantly obvious what they're trying to do, what they're trying to manipulate here. And it's such a pointless scene that feels so fake. It shouldn't be in the show. Like, I don't know how this got approved.
Yeah, it's the over, like, adoration of the prior work of a legacy sequel. It's the, this means something to the audience, so we have to pretend that the characters in the universe treat it as this, like, thing. So, like, we get multiple references in this episode to multiple of the original characters being legends. That's the word that's used. It's used, Raffi calls Worf a legend.
War.
Picard and Riker referred to as legends. Like, they're all being treated
at
like this
Worf,
special
I can
crew.
Understand, because he's, like, the first Klingon in Starfleet. So maybe people would hear about him, yes.
Yeah, yeah, you know? And that was true as well. Not the exact same thing, but that was true. Like, Spock had this reverence about him in Next Gen, and the idea that Spock kept, like, going forward and kept sort of, like, you know, he was literally forming some form of peace with the Romulans. Like, he was a big deal, right? Spock did actually sort of go above and beyond and become a legend.
Yeah, he became an ambassador and all that. Yeah.
But arguably, Kirk never did, right? He is to the audience because he was our captain and the main character that we all cared about, but he never became this, like, mythical thing in the show. In fact, there's a great...
Are all admirals in Starfleet legends?
There's a
know,
thing...
Because presumably they had a ship that went out.
There's a thing in, I want to say... Is that, maybe it's in Generations, maybe it's in, like, season one of Next Gen, maybe it's in both. But there's kind of this thing, the way, like, when the original Enterprise or the original show comes up and Picard, like, references back to it, there's kind of a, like, oh, that's James T. Kirk's ship. It's not, he's not like, oh, that's the legend, it's James Tiberius Kirk. He's like, oh, yes, I've heard of this ship and its travels. Like, yeah, this is James T. Like, it's sort of just like another part of Starfleet history.
I read
history.
About you in the history books because you made first contact with all these people who are now part of the Federation or something.
Yeah, it's not treated as this, like, oh my god, you're the legend, James T. Kirk. You've got a glow around you. I'm going to get down on my knees and say I'm not worthy because you're the legend of the Enterprise. And, this is a problem that I have with Ghostbusters Afterlife. It's a problem with the Star Wars sequel trilogy. It's a problem with Halloween 2018. It's a problem with almost every sort of thing that's came back. Jurassic World's trilogy has this problem.
I think it's worse to hear because... I've always thought of Starfleet as being the best, not of individual ships.
Oh, sure, yeah. No, I get what you're saying. You're saying that this is more, like, antithetical. You know what word I'm trying to say? This is more this is the opposite of what Starfleet in the context of the universe of the show has always been. This is flying in the face of that, just in the universe, on top of just the meta problems of they're treating it too, like special.
Yes.
Yeah,
that's why this is all these things are the reason why I just didn't like this episode.
Yeah, no. That what's funny is that stuck out less to me than Picard acting out a character. But you're absolutely right. As soon as you started talking about this, I'm like, yeah, this is the same thing that's been pissing me off and like a lot of things in the last five years.
I'm a Trekkie, like I'm a lifelong Trekkie, and like this is the stuff that bothers me. You know, it's not like. Yeah, canon stuff can kind of bother me sometimes, but I'm not, like, the biggest stickler when it comes to that. But I feel like everything should at least... I want the show to at least be written by people who have my knowledge at the bar. You know, that's, like, the baseline. Because there are definitely people who know way more about Star Trek than me, but I should be the baseline. That's what I'm trying to say. Like, if I have problems with it, and I'm, you know, someone who always looks for the positive... Did my video screw up?
Yeah, can I, Yeah, the connections. I'm going to keep this in because there's a couple of times where it sounds like we're interrupting each other in this, and I'm just leaving this in to explain. There's a more of a delay than normal, so if it sounds like we're being rude to each other, it's just the Skype connection. Yeah, no, this is just a problem in like beloved like franchise things recently, and you're right that it specifically flies in the face of what the Federation and like. But I think that's the problem with a lot of modern Trek, though, is that even the feel of a lot of modern Trek is that it's the wham bam action show now, right? So much of it feels like it's flying in the face of what Trek actually was when it was in its peak or its heyday or whatever you want to call it. So we get kind of this maybe double problem where at least, you know, if you've got a problem with, say, Jurassic World as a movie compared to Jurassic Park, it's obviously inferior, but it's at least still trying to capture what Jurassic Park is, even though it's doing a lot of, you know, things poorly as it's doing it necessarily. This is kind of weird where it's ashamed of being Trek as well as doing all the sort of, so they're it's this weird double-edged sword where it's both worshipping details and characters from Star Trek history but at the same time being ashamed of how those stories were actually told. So we get this action show that is also like over worshipping characters in a way that feels unnatural for the characters inside the story. So, yeah, it's
yeah.
Excellent point.
It's frustrating.
I never even thought of this, but this is such a me point. Thank you, Tara.
You don't get to take credit for it.
I'm not taking credit. I'm saying thank you for bringing it to my attention. This is good stuff.
I didn't hate the Worf stuff. I thought that was okay. And I mean, even Raffi, like at this point, she's like, "Oh, you're a legend," and I'm like about to roll my eyes, but then I'm like, "Oh, okay, I'll give it a pass for Worf. Like Worf should be at least more well known than everyone else, but like Geordi LaForge shouldn't be a legend in my mind, who had no friends."
I think obviously Michael Dorn's still very good at playing the character. He sounds like Worf, which is great. I will say though, like I was alluding to earlier, the way the plot actually plays out with Raffi and Worf, it just kind of feels like more of the same problems that I had when Raffi was on her own. It's the like they go to chase some guy who has some vague connection with the weapon being stolen at the Daystrom Institute, right? And it's just something that he brings up. Oh, there's this guy who we can go and interrogate. So their plot is to go and capture this guy who, my thought was, why are they running after the lead singer from Green Day? When I actually looked him up, though, it's the guy from the Terminator show, Thomas Dekker, I think his name is. But I thought he looked like the lead singer of Green Day.
Oh, I thought he looked like somebody else, but I can't think of it now.
That's not important. It's a bit of color, bit of personality on the commentary. But you know, they get him and they're interrogating him, and they think he's got withdrawal symptoms. Raffi's like getting in his face, like, "Oh, you want this, don't you? Because you're going through a withdrawal," and you know, I don't want to pick on her, but her acting's a bit, you know, she's always overdoing it, I think. And eventually the guy's face starts to ripple, and Worf, and it makes sense that Worf's like, "Wait a minute, I recognize this, because I know he's on Deep Space Nine, so I know he's going to know who Odo is, and if we're getting this big plot with some war with the Dominion and all this other stuff, like, okay, this makes enough sense," but I still don't like how we got there. And even after they have this scene where they eventually, you know, phase him when he's in liquid form, Their next thing is like, "Well, this was just a distraction." Yes, like you said, like two episodes ago. So let's go to the Daystrom Institute and find out what the real weapon was they got. It's still just chasing a MacGuffin. There's nothing interesting about how any of this like progression is written from scene to scene. All the interesting stuff for me was like, "Oh, we're going to get all this Odo stuff, and Odo comes from this race of people, and I'm excited for Deep Space Nine now." But the way the story's being told in this isn't that captivating. In fact, it's actually quite dull. It's just the next thing, the next MacGuffin we're going to, the next thing we're investigating.
Yeah, I mean, hopefully it doesn't spoil other stuff in Deep Space Nine,
not.
Because the show goes places, and
because honestly, the idea already that Odo's race, or whatever you want to call them, and don't correct anything if I'm wrong here, because I'm happy to be wrong to find out,
yeah,
what
I
Deep
won't.
Space Nine. But the implication from this is that, you know, his race are are going to be hostile and that they're going to try and go to war with the Federation or whoever. And that's exciting to me. The idea that Odo is going to be conflicted because he's, you know, with everyone in Deep Space Nine, and then maybe he's going to be like, oh, my people, oh shit, they're evil fascists or whatever. Shit. I have to, you know, and there's the one point Worf's talking about the one good man on the inside, and I'm like, oh, is that Odo? Is Odo with them and he's the one good one? I don't know. Don't answer. But yeah, so I'm excited about all that. It's made me excited for Deep Space Nine because I actually like typically how Deep Space Nine tells its story. So that's cool. I'm halfway through season one. Me and Connor are reviewing it. We've been doing Next Gen for like 4 years at this point as well. That's where we are. We're halfway through season one of Deep Space Nine and season six of Next Gen.
Are you close to Duet yet?
On what show?
On Deep Space Nine.
I don't know. Is that a season one episode?
It's one of the best episodes of the show, and it's like a season one episode.
I'll tell you how far away we are from Duet. I'll tell you. I'm excited about Deep Space Nine. Deep Space Nine's an enjoyable show. When's Duet? Duet's the second last episode of the season, so we're still a few away from that.
Oh, yeah, you're still away.
Yeah.
Dang.
Don't worry. Mike from Breaking Bad's in the next one going out next week, though. Or this week, by the time this goes up.
I know which one it is.
Yeah.
It's the Kaio Paka episode.
Yes, yes. That's the one. So, aye. Yeah. It's so funny is that, you know, the last TV episode we reviewed was a new Quantum Leap episode, and that's been one that's been going down in our kind of opinions, maybe more so mine than yours, but I had a lot of critiques of that last episode, and I said all it was doing was making me want to watch the original show, which I've only seen a few episodes of. It's funny how this is now doing the same thing where I'm like, this is making me watch more Deep Space Nine. I'm all in on Deep Space Nine now, but I'm not feeling this necessarily. And I think that goes back to that original thing we were talking about how, like, you know, Ghostbusters Afterlife is about how good Ghostbusters was rather than how good it is as its own thing. And it's the same thing here. Star Trek Picard is about how good Next Generation was without actually, like, just being its own thing and being its own next chapter of these characters. There's a real problem with the way, like, franchise continuations are written these days, I feel, and because I'm having this problem in a lot of them, where it's more about going, oh, I remember this thing, than it is about giving me a compelling story about who the character is. And even though in theory, in paper, you know, season two of Picard, on paper, oh, we're going to go into Picard's, like, you know, traumatic backstory with his parents and, like, sort of add some layers to who he is. That sounds fine on paper until you sort of realize, wait, this contradicts things that were in the original show that he said about his parents or that we knew about his parents. You know, and before we even get to the poorly written elements of it, you know? So
I was more upset, like, you have this big journey to answer this question and it changes absolutely nothing about how Picard is or acts or any way I watch the original show. Like, I'm not going to think about it. I'm only going to think about how he said hung instead of hanged.
Well, that's
unless his mother was an article of clothing, she should have been hanged.
Do you know what it makes me think of? It reminds me of, like, so obviously, you know, I'm a big fan of the hit television show Buffy the Vampire Slayer, right? So after the show finished, there was a comic book which was, you know, quote unquote canon, right? And it lasted a while, season 8, and then season 9, and then eventually they sort of rebooted and just did, like, their own things. I've read all of season 8, and it's kind of a mixed bag. Some of it's kind of stupid, some of it's all right, but I'll tell you right now, no part of me when I watch the show thinks, oh, these characters go on to do this next. That comic book in my head is separate. It is a separate thing that is, like, a tangential thing that doesn't actually, it's not the actual future of these characters. When I get to the end of Buffy and I see that last episode, I don't think, oh, they're going to do this next because that's what I read in the comic book. I feel like this is kind of the same thing with this. I feel like when I get to the end of Next Gen, you know, when I get to the big finale episode and whatnot, I'm not going to sit there and think, oh, this is all these things that's going to happen to Picard and Riker in the future, because it probably, if anything, is just going to diminish or water down what that ending achieves. So, you know, you find yourself disconnecting from it in a way, I think.
Yeah, I guess. I don't know. Unless they really, you know, do something great with it. I guess I can separate things just fine. Like, that was that show and this is this new show. But I don't want it to be. Like, I want it to be something that's canon and something that I think about as a whole. Like, if you're going to bring back Picard and then bring back everybody, I want to know what happens to these characters. I want to know what Worf is doing.
I think
I'm curious about LaForge and, you know.
I think the more we keep getting more sequels and more franchise extensions, because it's just happening more and more and everything's getting them, basically, mm-hmm. is that the more you have to be okay with having a cutoff point where you say, no, that was the ending and everything after is just kind of separate.
Plus, like, plus the finale of Next Generation is really good. And you do kind of get like an ending for everybody in that. Not that they all die or anything, but like there is kind of like a, here are how people are doing later, you know? And I found that to be pretty satisfying that I guess I don't really need this season for that.
Yeah.
Or even the movies.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's the other thing I would say as well. And this goes back. This is something that I talked about a lot when, like, you know, Batman v Superman was coming out, but I think it applies to things like this. Is just having all the names and even having all the actors doesn't necessarily make it them again. You know, like, a character or a show in this case isn't just all the names that were in the show. It's, like, how the show was written. It was the ideals of the show. It was the way it told its stories. So just having Picard, Riker, Geordi, Worf, and whoever doesn't necessarily just...
The legend of Geordi LaForge.
It doesn't just make it mean that it's just magically Next Generation again, because it definitely isn't. It doesn't feel like Next Gen at all. It's just its own thing. If anything, we were saying how it's much closer to the original movies in terms of, like, its plot idea than it is anything from Next Gen. But it's the idea that the writing and how it actually handles its characters is arguably more important. I think if you got a successor show, let's say we get a new Star Trek show with some new name, like Star Trek, the blah, 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 right? And it was all new characters. But I think if it felt like it was written like Next Gen and it felt spiritually like it was like telling more stories like Next Gen, it would feel like more of an authentic follow-up than a show that just happens to have all the characters saying, hey, this is us 25 years later doing things, right? And being grittier and yelling at each other and dropping F-bombs and whatever it is. Like, it would probably feel like more of an authentic sequel to Next Gen, even though it's all new characters. Because the plot
details...
You don't
want the
plot details are not the important thing that makes something something. It's the soul of it, right? And that sounds a bit frothy as far as, like, language goes, but it really is true. It's what makes Next Gen Next Gen is how it makes you feel. And... Mm-hmm. The sequel to it, if you want a sequel that gives you more of that, the thing that's important is it feeling like that again. The details mm-hmm. They're just details. They're not actually that important. It's the stuff nerds love to go over. I blame 30 years of people obsessing over the make and model of Han Solo's blaster for this shit, by the way. But those aren't the important parts. It's who the character is that's important. It's how they act. It's how they, like, tell their story that's the important part.
I blame J.J. Abrams.
I mean, for Star Trek specifically, yeah, he's got a lot to answer for. That's true. But
and he did The Force Awakens.
He also brought in Alex Kurtzman into this mix, and Kurtzman still got his mitts all over all this modern Trek.
It's the Star Trek 2009 movie. It's The Force Awakens and this reverence for old things, and it's Alex Kurtzman. It all boils back down to JJ.
Yes.
Can I swear?
I'll give you one. Go on.
Fuck you, J.J.
Which, don't get me wrong, he's obviously a better filmmaker than like some people who have come and done stuff after him. But yeah, he's kind of the origin of a lot of the problems that we probably have with modern Trek.
Why do they have to be bullets? Why can't they just be fake? God damn it,
oh, no.
I can't.
Joe, I will say, I am glad that this is the last season, because I think it's easy to say we'll finish this out, we'll see how it ends, because
it's
it does kind of
making
feel
me sad.
We're getting to this nexus point here where I feel like, yeah, we are talking more about the effect of what this show has on our feelings of Star Trek as a whole, more than we're talking about the details of the show itself, right? And I think that's because that's how it's making us feel. It's making us sad because it's not as good and because it's missing the point. So I'm glad that we're nearing the end. I'm glad that, you know, this is not a thing where, like, oh, we have to, you know, decide if we're coming back for season 4. We don't have to, because it's not. We can just wrap it up and move on with our lives. But I think we're clearly at that point. I mean, on that subject, we're getting one last season of Discovery as well. That was news this past week, which is probably relevant to bring up here, is that there's only one more season of that. And Discovery, for all its flaws, is definitely better than Picard. And, you know.
No, I'm sad for that news. I like, you know, the crew and cast and yeah, I have problems with the show, but it's definitely the show with the most potential, you know? It's so far in the future. There's so much they could tell. So many stories they can tell.
Yeah. To give it credit, it didn't ruin the thing that it built up all season four like it did in season three. You know, I was really worried all season four it was going to, but it just did the peaceful ending. It didn't have to become a big action show in the last mm-hmm. episode, and I really appreciated that. So, yeah, it's watching.
I think it's bummer news, and I'm sure a lot of people are thrilled about it, but like.
I don't really feel much of anything because I'm very mixed on the show. But I mean, five seasons is a decent run. Like, five's not bad. Like, I don't feel sad when a show gets five. As long as they get...
Yeah, they were definitely planning on more, though.
Oh, sure. They probably were. Yeah. But they're getting to reshoot or shoot some extra stuff for the finale to give it more of a wrap-up. So they didn't write the whole season as if they knew it was the end, but they are at least getting to go in and add some bits and pieces to the ending to make it more of an ending. So.
Okay.
That's something, but is there anything else to talk about in the episode? I mean, I guess we didn't go into like the conflict at the end that much, but it's just basically Picard like, we have to fire Riker's like, no we can't, but then he has to sort of give in because they're kind of cornered, and then the blasts just get redirected back to them, so they end with them the Titans falling into the gravity well, they say it's at the middle of this nebula, so all hope seems lost.
No, everything's wiped out. No controls.
Yeah, which...
No impulse, nothing.
Probably means... I mean, who have been up? Like, yeah, Geordi's going to show up in a ship. The legend, Geordi the Forge, is going to show up and save
with
them.
No friends.
Yeah, that felt weird. I mean, I know he was a bit socially awkward with, like, meeting women and stuff in Next Gen, from what I've seen so far, but it doesn't feel like he's got that much of trouble making friends. He seems to be quite friendly with the rest of the crew.
Did they not, like... I mean, also, he had, like, a great friendship with Data. Like, he was the only one that had, like, an actual friend that we saw on the show.
Yeah. It's a bit... It's a bit odd. I
do like that Raffi's response to what... Worf gives her all these directions on what they're going to do next. And instead of her going like, well, that's suicide or that's not a good idea, her response is cool. Because I'm like, yeah, that is cool. I want to go on an adventure with Worf. She seems like the type that would do well with a Klingon.
It felt a bit try-hard to me, that moment. But I mean, that's just a personal thing, maybe. It just felt a bit, I don't know, felt a bit wing-winged.
I know you don't
audience.
Like Raffi.
Of course, like,
I mean, so much of it was already wink, wink. But like, yeah, that is the right response. Is
Raffi's plot was terrible last season, and it's terrible this season. Raffi's been a, but no, she's been honestly ever since she went to visit her son in season one. Like, I've hated her plot. It's been bad every season or every like episode since that, pretty much.
Yeah. Hopefully she gets the arc she deserves.
I want to point out, earlier in this review, you said, this is the thing I'm hoping will save the season. I think it's funny that we're in episode 3 and you're already using that language. This is the thing that will save the season.
Yeah.
That was a nice delay.
Yeah, the delay is pretty bad right now.
I guess we'll wrap up soon anyway, but I think we're pretty much done. It says something though that like I'm finding myself just more drawn to the older content with this, because when this references and like sort of goes, oh, this cool stuff from Deep Space Nine here, I'm not more excited in this show. I'm like, oh, the fact that you're treating it this way means that, yeah, people probably liked it back then for a reason. They made people liked it because it was well written and actually connected with the audience, not because Deep Space Nine, and I've not seen all of it, so I'll say Next Gen. Next Generation didn't just like work because it was like banking on like, oh, remember the original series and how great Kirk and all that were. No, it built its own characters, it gave us its own complex themes and its own complex ideas, and it mattered on its own terms. You don't have to see a single second of the original series to completely get and understand and appreciate what Next Gen is. And it feels like, from what I've seen of Deep Space Nine, that the same is going to be true of that. Yeah, there's some connections and crossovers, but yes.
When you watched Relics, which had Scotty back in it, Did everyone know who Scotty was, like, when they saw him? The legend of Scotty?
I don't think the greatest engineer
in Starfleet history.
I don't think they did.
I don't think they did either.
Yeah, I think they had to look
like,
him up.
Obviously, they knew who Spock was. McCoy, like, had a tour of the ship in the pilot episode. Maybe you could say that was a bit of a stretch, too. But he was, like, the oldest living human at that time. Maybe that's why they were giving him a tour.
Yeah, I don't think they did just instantly know who he was. I think it was like, no, we looked him up. Oh, he served in the Enterprise when Spock was there. So that gives them some context. It wasn't like, oh, he's this legend. You know, the greatest engineer that ever lived in Starfleet kind of thing.
Yeah, well, I guess Sarek was also back from that series, but he would be important because he was ambassador to Earth from Klingon. Not Klingon, for Vulcan. My brain.
Yeah, but those things were relatively few and far between, and they tend to do interesting things with them when they did come up. Not always, but they tended to. But it would work. Like, all the great episodes of Next Gen, though, by and large, are completely self-contained into Next Gen itself.
Oh, yeah.
Like,
nothing.
Measure of a Man, The Drumhead, like, all these episodes, Q-Who and the Borg first show up, works completely on its own, in the context of Next Gen. None of it is leaning on your nostalgia or remembering the original series. Whereas when I watch this show, all I can feel is, like, hey, remember how cool Next Gen was? And how much you care about all these characters because they're from Next Gen.
Remember Seven?
Remember Seven?
Why would Seven know? Who cares? Why would Seven know who LaForge is? Yes, he was a legend.
And that was the other thing.
Thank you.
Wouldn't Raffi...
Thank you for saying I don't have friends just like him.
Wouldn't Raffi have... Like, I feel like Worf is explaining. He's like, oh, there were great enemies of the Federation. Like, if there were great enemies of the Federation, wouldn't Raffi have some knowledge of this? Like... Maybe not an expert,
probably.
But she would probably have like a broad idea of this war that happened.
Yeah, they'd probably be part of like the breakdown of what's in the Gamma Quadrant to look out for.
When they're at Academy, and they're learning the ins and outs of the universe. Makes some sense. So that scene kind of feels forced to me because it's like, oh, we're explaining this for the people who didn't watch Deep Space Nine. But like, Raffi should know some of this. Like, some of it she wouldn't, but like, the broad strokes of it, it feels like she probably, you know, like... Like, because later on, like, Jack knows what a changeling is, because when he wakes up after being attacked, he's like, oh, there was a changeling, there's a changeling on board, right? Everyone knows what a changeling is.
Mm-hmm.
So that information is widespread. Like, that's, like, gone through the system.
Yes. Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't know.
Starfleet should definitely know who changelings are.
I'm just... I think, you know, I enjoy Strange New Worlds. I know you're not as hot on it because you like the captain as much, but... I enjoyed Strange New Worlds. It kept things simple. I think Trek as a whole, though, will benefit greatly when there's just someone else in charge who kind of appreciates Trek for what it was in the right ways. And I'm not saying you have to make the exact same types of shows before. By all means, evolve it. Because Next Gen was an evolution of the original series. Deep Space Nine already feels different to me in the way it handles things from the Next Generation. Like, you can evolve it. There's nothing wrong with that. But...
Yeah.
Don't just chase...
Even Voyager. Voyager definitely has the same feel, but a different premise.
Yeah. But they keep chasing the same... Like, and I'm going all the way back to the J.J. Abrams movie here. They're chasing the action Star Wars spectacle movie, and they keep fighting for that as much as they can. And I don't think it's a fit. It hasn't felt like a fit. It's not that there's no action in Star Trek. Like,
you know what show kind of nails it, though?
Yeah.
Prodigy? Like, Prodigy might be the closest thing that nails the feeling of it. Oddly enough. And it's not even, like, in Starfleet.
I don't know. The whole thing's just a bit depressing. Do you know what's funny? Is I didn't feel that negative about the episode. I felt negative on certain parts coming into this, but the more we've talked about it, the more you've, like, sort of pointed out other things that I agree with, and I'm like, eh.
Yeah, I think my disappointment is probably a little contagious. Plus, you're so easy to, like, you're like a sponge when it comes to negativity.
That's not fair.
You're feeding me right now.
No, I agree with you because I think you're right. I think you made a valid point, right? And the fact that I instantly could compare it to, like, 10 things shows that I think there's validity to what you were saying. And I think this show's suffering from the same problem, right? Play the character. I might play the character up a little bit where I'm like feeding off the negative energy and whatnot. But that this is not that. I think that is a valid point, and I'm backing you up. Damn it.
I want the show to be good. I want Star Trek to be good. I just love Star Trek so much.
one day it'll be good again. I have faith that it will be. At some point, like, it'll change hands. Someone else will be in charge of the writing.
Star Trek Discovery Season 1 was great. I love all of Lower Decks. I haven't finished Prodigy, but as far as what's out. But I actually do think Prodigy is really great. There's good stuff out there.
I don't feel the same way about Discovery Season 1, as you know. But, you know, that's fine. That's fine. All right. Well, Tara's cat's about to demolish the place, so we shall wrap up here. Give us your thoughts on episode 3 of Picard. And what's shocking is I am seeing some positivity online for this season so far, and it makes me a little sad because it kind of feels like the nostalgia shit is just working. Like, you know, it doesn't matter that the writing's not good. Like, it's just working because enough people will be happy enough with the nostalgia and be filled by it that they won't care about anything else.
It took me 1.5 seasons to finally give into it, so the nostalgia is strong, you know. And I especially now that you bring back Worf is obviously a huge fan favorite across 2 series, so mm-hmm. he's the one that we've all wanted to see again. And even Michael Dorn has been vocal about like bringing Worf back and maybe being in maybe Worf gets a ship and let's see those adventures of Captain Worf, you know. But it's not enough anymore. It's not enough for me anymore.
Oh,
I'm just sad.
And it definitely wears off in part because they keep doing more of it. It's the same thing that happened with Star Wars. When Star Wars came back, it was this huge thing. Star Wars is back, and then they released a movie every year. And then by the time we had the 5th movie, it was like, oh, you know, the shine is off of this. Like, people are now seeing the flaws and seeing, you know, the weaker elements of what these new movies are because, like, the mystique's gone. Same thing with Star Trek. You know, Star Trek's been back for years now through multiple shows, and it's like, at a certain point, like, the quality has to matter. It can't just exist. It's not enough to exist. You have to be good, too.
Okay, I can only handle an hour of shitting on Star Trek before I have to revert back to my liquid form.
Okay.
I think we need to end this.
Okay. Well, I'm still enjoying Next Generation, and I am very excited about Deep Space Nine to give you some positivity. So, and then one day I'll get to compare Deep Space Nine and Babylon 5 properly, and we'll see how that goes. Tara will probably break the internet if I go the way she doesn't want me to. But
I mean, it wouldn't make any sense to me, but I'll just think you're lying or wrong. Very, very wrong.
Good to know. But that is our thoughts on episode 3 of Star Trek Picard, which kind of turned into like our thoughts on just Star Trek as a whole right now. But Les, what do you think of the show and the season? Is the nostalgia enough to cover up the mediocre at best rating? And honestly, I don't think it's even mediocre. I think it's downright bad a lot of the time. But let us know. You can like, subscribe, ding the bell for notifications. All that stuff does help out, as does, of course, going over to patreon.com/mailfuzzTV and supporting us there. And we'll get back to, you know, things we're positive on in the near future, we promise.
Mm-hmm.
But you can also check out our sci-fi movie podcast over at Male Fuzz Movies called The Atomic Cinema Experiment, where me and Tara talk about sci-fi movies every week. And there's some bad movies, there's some good movies, there's some excellent movies, there's some terrible movies. There's a whole variety of positivity and negativity over there, so go and check it out. But that's us. Thank you once again for watching or listening. We always appreciate it. Keep watching TV. Have you got any vanilla?